So that OBD2 port is right down here. So you can see it right there when you reach your head down. I'll plug it up right now.
Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. So today we're going to be doing a quick little project on my Sienna. I've been working on my Sienna lately, so I've got it jacked up, the front bumper off and the hood off. And one of the things I wanted to do was to activate the security system. I've got a Sienna SE, so the SEs and the LEs and the Ls don't have the security system enabled from the factory. They have it all pre-wired and it's an option in Techstream, but they haven't activated it because they don't have a hood latch, and that's really the only thing missing, the hood latch hood pin. So I'm gonna go install that today, and I'll show you guys. If you just want to buy the hood latch pin, you could buy it and install it, or you could do a rig and wire up your own hood pin and get it to work also. I'll show you that, and I'll have a link down in the description of the parts and instructions on how to do that. So stay tuned. Right here I've got a hood latch that I bought on eBay. You could buy these OEM or aftermarket on eBay. I think the aftermarket one's only like $40 or something, maybe $50. I bought this used, and maybe I might have paid $60 for it used. So the reason why I bought it is because it comes with this hood pin or this hood switch, right, with the wire harness right down here that plugs into the harness already on the radiator support. So if you have a limited or an XLE, this is already an option on your car, so it's not even an upgrade. You already have it as part of your system and the security is enabled. But for the SEs, the LEs, and the Ls, this does not come standard, and you can activate it in Techstream. If you activate it in Techstream without this hood switch, it's gonna buzz like your hood's open all the time. It becomes annoying. Well, it doesn't work, so it thinks your hood's open because it's reading this switch as open. I actually have a link down in the description of, you know, the part number for this switch, and you can actually just install it on here. It's held on by like two little screws. You can see one right there going through, and I believe it might be just that one screw. And yeah, all it does is it triggers when the hood's open or closed, and then it's got this wire harness on it. I think that switch you could order, but it doesn't come with a wire harness, so you gotta make your own, and then you'd have to hardwire it to get it onto the car unless you had this plug, right? So right here we have the radiator support, so the radiator support has this hood pin switch right here. So the harness is here on the SEs and the LEs and the Ls already. So you don't have to do anything but plug it in, right? So that's the easy part. And then this guy is only held on by 3 10mm, and then there's one behind this little cap here. You gotta pop this plastic cap off, and then you take that one out, and then you unhook your cable. Put the new one on, plug it up, and that's it. That's pretty simple, straightforward. So I'll do that in a minute, and you can see how simple it is to swap that out. So you can see on here, it's got two little holes, and that's one of them's for the screw, and one of them's for the alignment for that hood pin that fits behind there. And then when I take these off, I'll show you side by side. These things are pretty much identical on both of them as far as the design and the build of it. I mean, it is the same except for the switch, I guess. So you over here, the one that has a switch on it, you got the guide hole and then the screw hole, and this one's just got two blanks right there. And then if you look on the back side, it's pretty much the same thing. I think the only difference is that little E6 or L4 or whatever that was on the middle bolt, but that's probably just some kind of date code that they use. But yeah, that one's got the switch on it right there with the cable coming out, and then that one right here has got nothing behind it. So yeah, if you could get that switch or source that aftermarket switch, which I don't even think it's aftermarket. The one I found, or the instructions I saw, it's actually an OEM switch, but you just swap it in there, wire it up, and then wire it up to the car, and you have yourself a cheap switch, I guess, or cheap hood pin. We'll be right back. So there it is, pretty simple install. 3 10 millimeter screws, put that cap on, plug in that harness, and you're done. Don't forget to hook that cable. I almost forgot to hook that cable before I started bolting things down. So I'm gonna show you how to enable this in Techstream right now. I'll do a screen grab and kind of walk you through the options in Techstream. So we're in the middle of quarantine 2020, so my wife's got her OCD germaphobe cardboard floor mat when she goes out. I don't understand it, but she's taking her precautions. So the OBD2 port is right down here. So you can see it right there when you reach your head down. I'll plug it up right now. My car's got footwell lights that I upgraded. Maybe one day I'll do a DIY video on how I did these footwells, but they really, for this car, it really makes a big difference doing that footwell lighting, especially when we're driving and trying to find stuff or opening the doors. So once we connect up Techstream, we want to connect to the vehicle. So you click on connect to vehicle up here in the corner. This process usually takes a while because it has to connect to the car and the communications is not that great. It's like an old serial communication protocol. So I just go ahead and skip forward off from here once it does this thing. So we get to this screen where we have to select what model we have and what options we have. So for this car, we have to select others. Then we select smart key and then OK after this and let it connect. So we get to this menu screen and we see all these yellow. Yellow means that Techstream hasn't connected to the ECU yet. So we'll go over here and connect customize settings for what we're looking for. So we get into the settings menu and then we see all the options we can do. So the first thing we're going to go look at is up here at security. So we'll click on security to get to that menu. So we get into the security menu and you see that's warning by horn and then warning by the glass break sensor, which are the two options that we could select in here. So we want to turn both of those on. I'm not sure what the glass break sensor is. I guess it uses the Bluetooth mic maybe to detect glass breaking, but either way, I just enable it whether we have the sensors or not. So after we're done with that, we have to go over here to options setup. This is where the security settings are. So you go into there. Once it brings up the menu, you just hit on for the security system. And then once you click on, you go down and just hit the forward arrow and then let it set. So after we're done with security, we'll look at some of the other settings in here and the options that we could do. We'll go look at illuminated entry. So in this menu, you can set the various lighting modes. Once you, walk up to the car, if you want the lights to come on and off and all that. So you can see the menu here and set what you want to set. So after illuminated entry, we'll go look at light control. Light control controls various aspects like the sensors, how bright, how dark you want everything set. And then, the time delay for it to turn off once you get out of the car. And then it's also got this DRL disable button that you can do, or the function. And this one is on top of the what you can do with your stock. So if you have one of the non-SEs or non-limiteds and you don't want the high beam DRLs on, you can use this setting to disable it all the time. That way you can still use your auto setting, but you don't have to worry about the DRL. So the next setting we're gonna look at is the power door controls. So this one's got a bunch of different settings that you could do on, so you could have it where it doesn't beep, and it doesn't, the buttons, what the buttons do, how you unlock them, how you lock them, and all those various options that I've never really messed with. There's a lot of stuff here that I don't really understand or I don't really need to customize as much, but at least the option is there and you can see all the operations on here. Next menu we're gonna look at is the power windows menu. This thing's got a lot of different disable and enable buttons for all the different windows and the auto up, auto down, and all that. I've got it all on mine. It's nothing that I really want to mess with. So we'll go look at the lock options on this car. So you could set it to lock with the key pushing twice. You also set it for the parking lock or or speed lock. I have mine set on speed lock where it goes up to 13 miles an hour. It locks all the doors, and then I have it set where it only unlocks the door when I open my door after I turn off the car, instead of having it when it's in park. So next menu we're going to look at is the warning sounds in this car. So here you can set the different sounds, like the chiming when you forget your key in the car, the seatbelt warning, the low battery warning, and then the number of flashes when you have the lane changing on your car. So we'll go into the air conditioner menu right now to see what options we have in here. So in here you can set the various temperature offsets, the evaporator control, which is on all on automatic, your fan auto off, auto mode is on, and then there's this one right here, which is the outside air, the fresh air setting. On my car, I just have it off. I want to be able to control that myself. The next menu we'll look at is the display menu. The only option here is for the odometer, a time that stays on when you open the door. So we'll go into the smart key settings right now. So in here, you could just set the park wait time. I'm not even sure what that is on that. You can set your ignition area, whether if you wanted all the sensors in the car or just the front. That way, if you have the keys up front, you can only start it up front, or if you have the keys in the trunk, you can still start the car. The rest of this stuff is just the door operations using a remote, like how long you press the rear door for, if you want to press unlock all the doors with one press or two press. And this last menu right here is for the touch activation on each door. So if you want to activate that or deactivate it, so you could unlock your door or lock your door. I think you use it for locking the doors. So I think that's all you could really set in these menus. So next we'll go ahead and look at the smart key system. And the smart key system, at least on this car, the one I have, it lets you program your key fob or new key fob. So you go in here and you go under utility, and then it brings up a menu where you can see the different things you can do. You can erase, you can mess with the ECU, you can register your keys. There's several ways to register it, and then you could, like I said, you could erase all your keys, you could register new keys and all that. It depends on, I guess some of these are options if you lose all your keys and you have to program it a certain way. I'm not sure. I've never really messed with this, and I don't want to mess with it in case I mess up my own car. So I'll just leave this as is right now. So next we're gonna go mess with the TPMS. So you go over here to all ECU, and then under tire pressure monitor, you'll pull this menu up. So once you go into this menu, you go to utility, and it pulls up the list of what you can do. Then you wanna go to ID registration if you wanna program your TPMS. The thing with Toyota cars is, and Techstream, you have to have all four or five of your codes with you and program it all at once. You can't program just one sensor at a time. So you just make sure you write down all your codes before you accidentally erase them all. I usually just print out the data list that has a list of all my sensors on my car. That way, in case something happens, I can always reprogram it back in. So I'm going to stop the programming on that before I mess anything up. So I'm going to go up and pull up my data list and show you my sensors here. So you can see all my sensors right here, and they were all from the same batch because all the serial numbers were about the same starting numbers right there. So over here on the side over here, you can see that I've got mine set the threshold when it starts warning, when you have a tire warning to fill up your pressure, which is usually about 80% of your, you know, total value that you set. And then over here is what I'm reading right now. Everything's at about 33 PSI. I usually run about 38, so that means I gotta air up all four of my tires to 38 before I get a warning soon. And then down here you can see that I've got it shows the battery levels, and it's odd that one sensor that shows everywhere else is showing it's not showing a battery level, but the other ones are. Even that spare tire one that's not even on my car is showing over on the battery level, but then that one that's not reading for some reason. But I don't think it's a problem. It's probably just an error because the car is not on. I think I've shown the gist of Techstream and its capabilities to customize and do stuff yourself. I think I'm going to call it quits for this tutorial for now. I think I'm already at 8 or 9 minutes on explaining to this.
Thanks for watching all the way to the end, guys, and I hope you guys got some information from this video on
you know, setting up that security system for your Sienna and all that Techstream stuff I showed you guys on the screens and the menus and all the options for this car and what you need to do to connect to it and make any adjustments you need to and do all the customization to this car and, you know, program keys and whatever it was that I was showing you in those menus. I hope you found that useful, and if you like the video, just remember to like it. Subscribe to your channel if you want me to watch my other stuff that I do on the Sienna and I do on the Lexus and, you know, stuff I do around the house, technology stuff and car stuff. So anyways, I hope to see you guys next time on the next video.